Welcome to the auditorium of the Eindhoven University of Technology in the middle of Brainport. That's the center there where innovation starts, I would say. So we're at the right place here in the auditorium of the TUI. The official opening this morning, probably some of you. Did you join this morning's program? Some of you who? Hands, please. Yeah? Wow. So we've been here all day. And now is the moment, almost here. That will be in just now, because we have a very full program for you. A range of speakers will come to the stage and tell you something more about the tunnel or about what they do.
Let me see.
Yeah, let me go first to the stage. The Rector Magnificus of our university, ladies and gentlemen, here is Frank Baijens.
So good afternoon and a warm welcome to our university. Quite a few of you have been here already for a full day and had a very interesting symposium. We're here to open a new lab that we have, the wind tunnel, the atmospheric boundary layer tunnel. I had to look up what it exactly means. I didn't know what atmospheric boundary layer exactly meant, so now I understand it. But essentially, you'll see that it's a big box, and some of you have seen it. And the question is, why did it have to be that big? I just had an argument about that with Beth, because essentially you're looking at the Navier-Stokes equation. And the Navier-Stokes equation is a beautiful equation, and it scales perfectly. So why couldn't it be a lot more smaller than it is today? And so the answer, I think, is pretty simple. Cyclists had to fit into it. So that probably decides the size of the tunnel. But I would like to pay a big compliment to Professor Bert Blokker. If you look in history, we've been talking about a big wind tunnel already from the 70s. And many people have tried it, and obviously many have failed. But it takes, I think, something very special to take it all the way to the end. And probably you need to have kind of like the tunnel vision that many of the cyclists have. Because the only thing that they want to do is to go across the finish line in the shortest possible time. And you also had this. You don't take no for an answer. And you really pushed it through. And now we have a beautiful result of that, I think. I think at the end of the day, it's a beautiful lab. And that fits in the kind of vision, the strategy that we're developing for 2030. We're developing that strategy with a couple of key challenges in mind. The first is to create a sustainable future. Think about the challenges that we have in the healthcare system, the energy transition, mobility, the typical societal challenges that we're looking at this university. We're at the brink of the fourth industrial revolution, where we see a convergence of a number of disciplines, the physical disciplines, material sciences, digital sciences, biology, and so forth. And the other thing that we see is that technology is having an accelerating impact on society. It's really unbelievable. If you look at the past 15 years, what has happened with the technology and how that impacts with in our society. But the complexity of each of these challenges requires that we have the ability to collaborate in multidisciplinary teams. And so we, as a university, have identified a couple of areas where we would like to build up our strengths, our unique strength. And to name a few, it's clearly we are living in a high-tech environment, working on integrated information systems. Engineering biology is another example. But looking at the human-environment technology interaction is another area that we would like to focus on. And I think this sort of kind of fits in that last theme that I just mentioned. Now, an effective way to have scientists to collaborate is to create a shared infrastructure. And a lab like this is a beautiful example, I think, of that. A shared infrastructure means that you can work with very advanced, relatively expensive equipment. So it's cost-effective, but it's much more than that. It is a way to really get people together across disciplines and to share their ideas and to share know-how about what you're doing with the experiments. So that is kind of like what we see in the future. To enable this university to cross the disciplines that we have, to collaborate in multidisciplinary teams, and to work with the kind of shared infrastructure that you see here today. So in that sense, I think the Ventura Wind Tunnel fits perfectly in the future vision that we have for the university. It brings together scientists from various disciplines, but also students. You should never forget that this is a beautiful way of getting some hands-on experience for our students, next to solving these very advanced Navier-Stokes equations with computational methods. So I'm very much looking forward to exciting science emerging out of this discipline and having the cyclist cycle 1/10 of a second quicker, I think it is, something like that. That's the sort of order of magnitude that we're looking at. Once again, Bert, congratulations with a wonderful achievement, and I'm looking forward to the opening later on today. Thank you.
Frank Baaiens, thank you. Yeah, well, I told you a range of speakers will come to the stage, and we keep it close now with our university. She's the dean of the Department of Built Environment, but she does a lot of things. She's a full professor, advisor of the province of Brabant, and also the minister, I heard so. And in 2016, she was elected the most influential woman of this Brainport region. Yeah, I was there, so it's true. Ladies and gentlemen, Elfie Nelissen.
Thank you, Cindy. Well, this is a very memorable day for me, especially because we worked so hard for this. And, well, I remember about 4 years ago, in a time of, we had at least, decreasing numbers of students, my co-members of the board of the Department of the Built Environment and I, we decided to support Bert Blokken's initiative to take an opportunity to construct a large atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel on our campus. And it was not just something, it is really expensive, it's big, it's a lot of discussions went on, but we managed, huh, Bert? And this facility that's important to remember is that it's unique in Europe. It's really unique in its sort in Europe. And the executive board's supportive cooperation was, of course, crucial in realizing our ambitions. So we are very thankful for that as well. I thought Hans van Duin would also be present, but maybe he will be there later on. And at that moment, he was one of our big key supporters, and also he was, at that time, Rector Magnificus. So you can open it, Frank, but he was the first one to start with it. And we are really convinced that the investment will show to have been fully worth it and will lead to more and better research in the field of course, building aerodynamics at first, not just cyclists, and naval and sports aerodynamics as well. After many years of persuasions, discussions, prognoses, designs, redesigns, cost-cutting, answering a lot of questions like, why does it have to be so big? At last, our wind tunnel is ready and it's officially opened today. I'm so proud, I'm so happy and anxious to see the result of this research lab. The first tests were with a complete team of six cyclists have been already proven to be its benefits to our research. It's really good for our research. And I'm so confident that it will lead to the future we are dreaming of, and I'm really trustful that this will happen also because Bert is in the lead of this. I congratulate all of you and thank everyone who worked so exceptionally hard to realize this wind tunnel and to make this possible. So I'm just complete happy today and thank you for being here.
Elfie Nelissen. Yeah, we are in the city of Eindhoven and they are also very proud to have this within their borders, this wind tunnel. And yeah, true, I think. Yeah, it's true, yeah. So, and Eindhoven has the first alderman of design, and she's here, also the first alderman of design in the Netherlands. And will you come to the stage? Marianne Schreurs?
Thank you. It's even better. I'm not only alderman of design, I'm alderman of innovation. And you may think this is actually quite big. Well, actually, Bert is using the whole city as his lab. At this moment in time, he's creating the lungs of Eindhoven. And the contention is that you can take the peat and the small particles out of the air. And of course, he has a model that shows what probably the result will be. But as we all know, reality always escapes you. So we are dying to know what actually will be happening. And then we want to scale up as fast as possible. Because actually, people are suffering from the peat and the small particles in the air. And that's the most important thing. If you come to the Technical University, of course, it's very exciting what everybody is thinking. And I used to say, well, thinking is the most sexiest thing that you are able to do. And probably it still is. But the most important thing to do is to make life better. And we feel so tremendously blessed that within the borders of this city, we have a university with people like Bert who are able to do that. And yes, they will not be doing that on their own. They need other scientists, the industry, and of course, also the people for whom you are doing it. For you measure the results in the end by measuring what it does in the body of people, in the lives of people. This is just one step for you, and you will be making a lot of other steps. And as a conclusion, I want to state the following to you. Of course, you think that you are a scientific institution and that you are involved in technology. But most of all, you are a cultural institute. For the things that you do with technology are answers to cultural questions. What is quality of life? What kind of society do we want to be? The real culture is created in this university. And that's the reason that we are so glad that you are here. Never leave.
Thank you. Wow. And that's why we love her so much, Marianne Schreurs. Thank you, Marianne. Yes, some of you saw him this morning, and I saw a lot of you were here this morning, so you know already who he is. He works at the Concordia University in Canada. He's our honorary doctor here at the university also, and specialized in wind engineering and building aerodynamics. Ladies and gentlemen, may I proudly present to you Ted Statopoulos.
Good afternoon, dear Rector Magnificus, dear distinguished university administrators, honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen. Dreams sometimes become a reality. I'm particularly happy, honored, and humbled for your invitation to participate to this great ceremony on the occasion of the opening of the atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel of the Eindhoven University of Technology. Having in this university one of the best programs in the world in the fields of urban physics, wind engineering, and industrial aerodynamics, it becomes really redundant to stress the importance of these fields to you. However, it is also true that universities that want to keep leading roles in these fields in the world must have atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnels as research facilities in order to be able to supplement their field measurements and computational advances with experimental results. We had an excellent debate this morning on good and bad practices in wind tunnel testing, and of course, panelists came all from universities and institutions with excellent wind tunnel facilities, including but not limited, I'm not going to mention my own university, but the University of Birmingham, the University of Southampton, the University of Surrey, ETH Zurich, Ruhr University Bochum, Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, University of Florence, University of Liège, but also from top research institutes such as TNO, the Dutch German Wind Tunnels, von Karman Institute for Fluid Mechanics, CSTB, Nantes, France, if I didn't miss any. And that is very, very important that now also the Eindhoven University of Technology finally has such a wind tunnel, which actually makes it the only university in the Netherlands with such a facility. It is really surprising that in the past, no university in the Netherlands had such a facility, which of course made this country a rare exception worldwide. But it is absolutely a sign of excellent university government that the Eindhoven Institute of Technology recently chose to support the design, construction, and exploitation of a brand new atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel, putting a lot of trust to the abilities and the vision of Professor Dr. Bert Blocken and his research team. I would also like to share a personal experience with you. I'm particularly moved to be here today because back in 1999, I spent part of my sabbatical leave here in this university, accepting a kind invitation from a pioneer in the field of urban physics and wind engineering, Professor Dr. Jacob Wiese, who was with us today and he attended this morning's symposium. In this very important year for my own academic career, I worked with several junior researchers and I also first met Bert Blocken, who was registered to take a short course in the area of wind effects on buildings and building aerodynamics that I prepared and delivered to graduate students, postdoctoral fellows, and research engineers from Netherlands, Belgium, and other countries. It was during my stay in this university that it occurred to me that an atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel would be indispensable to the research progress, so I developed a proposal for the development of an atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel and submitted it to the dean at the time. Well, it took 17 years and a lot of persuasive efforts for the seed to produce fruits. So I'm really happy today to be here and participate in this ceremony. Bravo to Eindhoven University of Technology. Bravo to Bert Blocken and his team. Bravo to the developers of the facility. Thank you very much.
And bravo to you! Wow! Yeah, now, I was about to say, 4 years the university had a wind tunnel on the wish list, but you already said it, so that's true. Yeah, it's a particularly exciting day for you, Bert Blocken, so would you please come and share your visions and your excitement with us of this wind tunnel. Ladies and gentlemen, you are now in... our spiritual father of this wind tunnel.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for coming, for being present here today. Everybody that knows me a little bit knows that I usually start and end the speech with a Latin quote. So today it's Horatius' turn, Horace in English. Magna est veritas et prevalet. And this means, the truth is great and it prevails. So in Badesa, I want to say two things. First is that I always very much like working with our good friends of the press. But in some cases in the past weeks, they were a bit too enthusiastic. Because I've seen some, very nice articles. But for the record, this wind tunnel has an exceptionally long test section, that's true, for an atmospheric boundary layer wind tunnel. But no, it's not the longest in the world. And it's certainly not the biggest wind tunnel in the Netherlands. But it has its unique characteristics. Second, the truth is that behind this realization, there's a huge team of fantastic people that did absolutely fantastic job. So a lot of gratitude is in order. And the risk of thanking people explicitly is that you forget somebody. And that's possible, so I apologize for that in advance. But first and foremost, I want to thank the present and the previous university board for supporting this wind tunnel. Our president rector Magnificus Frank Bayens, president Jan Mengelers, our vice president Jo van Ham, and our university secretary Nicole Umelen. And a very special thank you also to Professor Hans van Duin, our previous rector Magnificus, who wanted to be here today, but unfortunately could not make it. And without their support, I think we would not be here today in this beautiful room with this very nice audience. Also thank our department board, Elfie Nelissen, Susanne Udo and Bouke de Vries. They really brought our department to a new level, and that deserves a lot of appreciation and respect. I also thank my friends in the excellent Turbulence and Vortex Dynamics group of the Department of Applied Physics, because they supported this facility because they clearly saw that it complements their own wind tunnel facility. Then there's a lot of service departments that did a lot of work for this wind tunnel. So thank you Nathalie Poelissen, Ingrid Bevers, Walter Engels, Veronique Marks, Jan Pekelder, Hans Huver, Ward Dieriks, Marianne de Vaan and many others. That helped us. We also get great support from the communication team, so that was also very much appreciated. Then today's event actually has been organized by four exquisite ladies, Sandra, Monique, Leontine and of course Annelies Verschuren, and did a fantastic job for us. And then we had of course our technical services that also did a great job. The people that actually built this wind tunnel are unfortunately not here today, but there's live stream. So I want to thank Mario, Sigrid and Rolf. And unfortunately, they couldn't make it because their daughter has been admitted into hospital emergency. So yeah, we wish your daughter all the best. And you're always welcome here. So we will hopefully see you back here very soon. So when you have a new wind tunnel, you also need equipment. And for that, I really have to thank our Equipment Prototype Center, which is really, I think, a bright pearl at the crown of our university. And then our technicians of the unit Building Physics and Services. I thank the whole lab, but especially Jan Diepens, Geert-Jan Maas and Stan van Asten, who are really exceptional. Because before we had our own wind tunnel, Jan, Geert-Jan, Stan, my PhD student Yassin and me, would go testing in Liège with our good friends there. And sometimes it appeared that we needed more technical support than only the day that we planned. So it happened that Geert-Jan unexpectedly needed to stay an extra day in Liège. So then we had to book an extra hotel room. And we had to go to a Liège supermarket to buy a toothpaste, a toothbrush, fresh socks and underwear. And I can imagine that our financial administration has raised some eyebrows when they saw the expense form for underwear. But this is really, I think, a very nice illustration of the dedication of these fantastic professionals to our unit, our department and our university. And that's really, I think, what it means to go the extra mile. So while I'm about to finish my speech, I also want to thank very especially Olga Palucci, one of the PhD students who did a lot of work together with the exhibition team to get it ready. And I saw them still working on it yesterday, so it got finished just in time and they did a fantastic job also. I could not stop this speech without thanking our friends and colleagues at TNO because they helped us a lot with this wind tunnel. They were also so kind to when they dismantled their tunnel that we could actually reuse some of these parts in the equipment, which is extremely valuable, and even more so to get their support and their advice because they built up a lot of knowledge on wind tunnel testing in the past. So I'm actually also very proud of the speakers we have here today. And a few days ago, I was talking to Jan Bakelands, and he will also give a speech later. And he's, as you know, he's a top Belgian cyclist. And he told me, and That was actually quite a nice statement, and I didn't expect that, that he felt quite humbled to be in the list of speakers today. And yeah, honestly, actually, when I talk to Jan or I talk to Jolien or to other cyclists, I actually feel humbled because, I mean, I'm just a civil engineer and there's many thousands of them on this planet, but there is only so few top cyclists in the world. So I'm very happy that they are also here today. So finally, last but not least, I want to thank you, all of you. I think the wind engineering community is really like a very big family. And that so many of you came here for this ceremony, for this opening and for the symposium, that really means a lot. And I really thank all our speakers, our moderators. I also thank, of course, my family and my friends for being here, because your presence here is a true honor for me. So now I end my speech with a Latin quote. And actually, it's not a not a very elegant quote. And up to last night, I was doubting, should I mention it or not? But okay, I'll do it anyway. So as you know, this is University of Engineers. And well, not all people here today are engineers, so you will have discussions later on. And that will be quite special discussions, maybe. So the final quote by Horatius goes, Sus amico luto. And that's very concise Latin for big mud friend. And you really have to love the conciseness of the Romans. So actually what it means is, arguing with an engineer is like fighting a pig in the mud. It is only after the first few hours you realize that the pig actually enjoys it. Thank you.
Bert Blokker. Bert, one more question for you. People are asking me, will the tunnel run this afternoon or just take a look at it?
We could have it running, but I think it will already be quite an achievement if everybody fits into the wind tunnel hole. Maybe you should try that first and then see how far we go.
Okay, thank you. Bert Blokker! It's almost like you won a reward or something. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So, but it's quite a reward you have there. The past years you've been working with several companies and lots of people, we already heard that, and businesses, and one of them is ANSYS, a leading American software company. Together you've worked on improving performances of athletes and buildings. So, Thierry Marchal is here to say something about what you've done all those years. Ladies and gentlemen, Thierry Marchal.
Okay, well, thank you very much for being here today and for this welcome here. Well, Bert, congratulations to you, to your team, to the university for a very nice achievement. But this is just the beginning, because we will be very demanding for this very nice toys that you've got here. Because to some extent, indeed, I've got a chance to be the leader of sport, construction, and healthcare industry within ANSYS, which is a large American company developing software like a CCFD. Just to give you an idea, we are generating more than $1 billion of revenue every year. Just to show you that simulation today is becoming something extremely important. Yet, sport is a small element, because contrary to what we were discussing and mentioning a little bit this morning, industry is not just about money. Industry is also about image and communication. And I think that this kind of sport engineering is something extremely important. This is what has helped us and the University of the Technology University of Eindhoven, and specifically Bert Blokker, to be well known in the entire world, with possibly some social media posts with a quarter million views over there, with several communication along this line. Well, one of the elements why it's so important is that indeed we can be using simulation as a disruptive technology for that, for three major areas. And I was a little bit concerned that you would be annoyed to see again some cycling a picture today, so I was using some things different, other industry as well, to illustrate the importance of what Bert is doing. This is going far beyond simply simulation. First of all, when we see, and we were discussing this morning, modeling the swimming, we were working with Speedo in order to design their swimsuit that has been banned after Beijing. Because with their swimsuit, designed with simulation, It was giving such a technological advantage to the swimmer that they were winning between 85 to 90% of the medal at the Olympics in Beijing. Similarly, at the bottom, you can see the catamaran from Emirates Team New Zealand. They were winning this year, America's Cup. And well, we were very proud because we were working with them, and they did not defeat the other finalists. They crushed them 7-1 at the end, because they were using a lot of simulation. But coming back to what Bert is doing, all this simulation, all this CFD, by the way, do you know what CFD stands for? It's a colorful department. Because all this simulation means nothing if we don't have the validation. And that's why having this wind tunnel, having Bert, an expert in simulation and an expert in this wind tunnel analysis, is so important, so that we are gaining this kind of credibility. And this is one of the key elements to optimize the performance. That's not it. We were talking a lot with Bert, and we were calling the UCI, who didn't reply to us so far, in order to make sure that all these races are fair. Because we can see that to some extent, with all this CFD analysis, we have found out that there is a kind of aerodynamic doping. That means that some people can take advantage of the motorbike, the car following them. Similarly, and we are working on that, simulation can go beyond simply aerodynamics and modeling electromagnetics. So that's why this kind of small ball, or as you can see over there, when the ball is going into the goal, that means that the ball is sending a text to the referee. This is not science fiction. This is the reality. And in the future, they will help to find out where you are offside or in the corner. But maybe the last point, which is possibly the most important, and I know that Bert is paying attention to that for cycling, is to protect the athlete. And here for that, I want to take advantage of this example, where we were modeling the impact of two American football athletes shocking each other. This is creating some stress in the brain and leading to some concussion. Here what Bert is applying is to analyze the CFD analysis to make sure that there is no more cyclists which are dying on the road or being hurt on the road. So our activity can be much more noble than just optimizing performance. It can really make sure that the race and the competition is safer. And I would like to conclude with one comment to Marianne, because the entire world is jealous. 2 days ago, I was inviting Bert to speak to one of my webinars that has been induced by Indian people after all the pollution in Delhi. And I've seen that there were many Chinese people joining this webinar because of the pollution in Beijing. We've got more than 900 people who have registered to this webinar to listen to what Bert could tell us about the simulation. I was very proud of that. And 2 days ago in the morning, I was sharing on the social media, hey guys, we've got 900 people who are listening to how simulation can help clean the world. And I've got some people working for the European Parliament saying, okay, but start with Brussels first. So Eindhoven, you are in competition with Beijing, Delhi, and Brussels. That will be tough. But thank you, Bert, for all what you are doing, and we'll keep supporting you for a long time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thierry Michel from ANSYS. Oh, should I click it myself? I think. Because our next guest, I promise you a full program, so we're halfway through. a lot of people want to say something. I've been informed that you work in the field of fluid dynamics and fluid structure interaction in research and also in commercial environments. Founder and manager director of FD Global Limited, Volker Boetgereit.
I'll be fairly brief. I'm super excited to be here today for the opening of the tunnel because I've been watching it come through social media almost daily for quite some time now. Bert's the only guy I know who can get some reasonably sexy PR from an ongoing building site, and so I'm not surprised it's well attended because I'm sure people have been watching it for some time like me. But what was also pretty clear was all of the amount of hard work that's gone into it and dealing with all the it's a complex project. I've designed and constructed wind tunnels before, but I've supervised refurbishment. And for those of you who don't have familiarity with it, it's quite a project. It really takes quite a lot of resourceful work. So congratulations to Bert and his team for completing it. And completing it, not in bad time at all. And so the other reason I'm excited about it is because that I'm hoping that this is going to be the start of a very successful collaboration between our company and Eindhoven. We are in the process of building a global fluid dynamics capability that transcends market sectors and geographies. And we are doing so by aligning ourselves with world-class centers of excellence in the areas of technology that we need them. And so the first phase really of the development here in Europe is wind engineering. And so we are building a world-class wind engineering capability headquartered out of London, but with other regional centers. And so world-class in wind engineering has got global reach. If you want to be world-class in wind engineering, you need a world-class wind tunnel facility. And that's what Bert and his team have now created here in Eindhoven. And it's no small achievement. And so in collaboration with Bert, we're really looking to bring an industry and research center into life here. That's got global reach. Bert, congratulations to achieving that. Thank you.
Yeah, we've already talking about cycling, and who follow the media already saw them in action, the runners of the Lotto NL Jumbo team. And here's the manager, Richard Plugge. Your slide.
Yes, I'm this guy who will gain you some time in the schedule, because I will be really briefly. We are working together with Bert in the wind tunnel to gain time. You can see here what we win if we win a time trial with how much time, 0.0 seconds. No, it's only 2 seconds here. Where's the 1 second? There. It's the 1 second in 11 kilometers in the Ruta del Sol last year. That's how important aerodynamics are for us. So that's why we are so incredibly proud and honored to be here at the opening. And by working together with Bert and the university. And we hope it's all about team with us in our sport. And we hope we can team up for the coming years to even gain some more time together to win more races like this. We won 7 time trials last year, thanks to already the 3D scans you did, the computer simulation we did together, and hopefully in the coming years we can win more races. And you can see, and that's why I wanted to show this, in how many cases, how little seconds we need to win a time trial. And it's not only in time trials, it's also in team time trials. And Bert built a wind tunnel where we can now look into a team aerodynamics. And we did that. I think we're going to see a movie in a second. And hopefully, coming year, the result of our cooperation will be that we will win a team time trial with our team. That will be the ultimate proof of our collaboration. Thank you. Congratulations on the result. And I'm here around, so please ask me all about cycling and about winning. And maybe for the Dutch people who follow the news, a little bit about sleeping pills, but not too much. Thank you. Thank you. And congratulations.
Richard Plugge. And now it's for me, seeking if she's here. Did you see her, Bert? No. I'm just going to call out her name. So I hope she will come to here. Because she's an Olympic champion. And we're proud that she is in our middle. I don't know. Actually, here in our middle or already at the tunnel. Maybe she's waiting there for us. Olympic Games in Rio, she won bronze. Current world champion at the Madison. That's track cycling. She now is riding for Orica Scott. Jorien, are you here? Jorien Dore? And now I hope that someone will say, yeah. No one? No? No, Jorien? Maybe she's coming to the tunnel. You can meet her there. But we have another great cyclist from Belgium in our middle. Also a professional bicycle racer in the 2013 edition of Tour de France. The yellow jersey was for you in stage two. But in October, you were severely injured because you got into a crash in the Giro di Lombardia. And he is here. I believe 7 ribs are broken, backbone got fractured, and you're here. Ladies and gentlemen, and walking, may I have a round of applause for Jan Bakelands. First question for you, how are you doing?
I feel better and better every day, but these were substantial injuries, so it won't be a quick recovery. But in the end, everything will be okay, and I look forward to be back racing next year.
Okay.
Not quite sure when this will happen, but it's sure it will happen next year.
Okay, so, whew, now he's still with us. Thank you, and share your notes with us.
Definitely, like Professor Blokken told me before, the most intellectual audience I ever had. But that's, for me, a nice challenge. I prepared in Dutch, but because I understand most of you are English-speaking, I will try to to do it in English. Already, Richard Plugge gave a really good overlap to what I am going to say, because in the recent years we see the importance of aerodynamics in cycling more and more. I saw this evolution coming up in the beginning of my career. It started with high-profile rims, then you saw coming over the aerodynamic frames, and in recent years you see there's some teams really paying attention to gain the maximum out of it and to frequent wind tunnels themselves. They know it's this marginal gain that will make the difference between winning a race or finishing second. I'm also intrigued by aerodynamics, and that's why I contacted last year Professor Blokken. Yeah. I didn't know at the time he was such cycling passionate, but yeah, I immediately had a good feeling about my cooperation with him, and I hope in the near future we will get even more out of it. So far, we had already some analysis about the TT helmets we use in the team. I already had for a long time the impression they slow us down. And the research with computational analysis really showed we have a disadvantage. I passed my information to the team. Now it's up to them and to make the changes. I hope next year we will truly see a change, and we can have with our leader, Romain Bardet, the aim of winning the Tour de France, I think, after finishing second and third, a completely realistic goal. The opening of this wind tunnel gives even more tools to check our findings in reality, and I hope this will happen. And I already saw in Twitter the example of the Lotto Jumbo team testing 6 of their riders in the wind tunnel. And to my knowledge, it's the first time six riders as a team went to a wind tunnel to optimize a team TT performance. And I think this is not a coincidence, because at Lotto Jumbo they already studied the Tour de France course of next year. And in my opinion, and I think I'm never wrong, or not wrong in this, never wrong about cycling tactics at least. This stage is really going to be a key stage, and I wouldn't be surprised if Professor Blokken's knowledge will help Lotto Jumbo to win even this TT. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, when you rinse, we know it's on you. Yeah, wow. Our last speaker, also an Olympic hero. He won in Rio gold and bronze as a cyclist, four-time world champion. He's in our middle. And also he's a senior lecturer at the civil engineering at the University of Galway and collaborating with our university. Owen Clifford, would you be the last one here on stage telling us something? And maybe I should say it was at the Paralympics. But still an Olympic hero, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. So I guess, I suppose I was to talk about cycling as well, and Richard and Jan would have mentioned quite a lot of what I wanted to say. And, you know, I think it's been fantastic for me to work with Bert on a project we're working on at the moment around Paralympic cycling, because I think that the development in the Paralympics has been such that the athletes deserve the type of attention that professional athletes or able-bodied athletes have been getting before that. And when I suppose when we first started on this line about trying to model Paralympic athletes, I knew immediately that the person that we would like to work with at NUI Galway would have been Bert. So we're absolutely delighted and privileged to have worked with him. I think this wind tunnel will make a huge difference to both that area of work, but I also think what's fantastic to see is the application of these type of skills to Paralympic athletes. I think will have a huge benefit for society in general, because it will help promote the Paralympic Games, and I think it will give people with disabilities, I suppose, the opportunities to compete at the highest level, but also the access to the best engineering and science that is available to all other athletes, which I think is important in terms of inclusivity in society. Just two final comments. As I said, I'm absolutely delighted and proud to have been asked to speak here today. And I might end by just making a point on the Navier-Stokes equation. You may not know this, but George Stokes was originally from Ireland, so you can thank him for a lot of what's going on at the moment. So thank you very much.
Owen Clifford. Yeah, now, the moment is finally there. May I ask Elfie Nelis and Frank Bynes to do us the honor? Because now we need the blue button. I don't think it's a button, but we pretend that it's a button. And when you press it, or it's like a big magic ball, don't you think? Then we call it officially opened. Our tunnel, yeah.
Do we have to bang? Or?
Yeah, don't just do something with it. But I would say do it simultaneously.
Yeah, yeah.
And then
okay.
like, and then they make a photo.
You have the camera.
Look at the camera there.
Okay.
And then I say 3, 2, 1.
Yep.
And then you press 3, 2, 1.
I was second with the start in Apeldoorn Giro, behind Dumoulin for a couple of thousandths of a second. We just want to turn the things in our advantage. Tenth of a second is all I need.
This new wind tunnel at Eindhoven University of Technology has a total length of 46 meters and contains a 27-meter-long test section. This allows testing groups of 6, 8, 9 cyclists or more in a team time trial or sprint train. Thanks to 4 huge fans and a series of high-precision force sensors that can be placed in any position, we can measure with an accuracy of 1,000th Newton. This system is capable of measuring the wind force on a paperclip. And it's not just athletes who can benefit from this wind tunnel. Measurements of wind speed and turbulence around buildings can help to improve the safety and comfort in complex urban areas. By analyzing the dispersion of air pollution, we can contribute to a cleaner and healthier environment. The wind tunnel is also fully equipped to optimize the aerodynamics of transport and racing vehicles, to determine wind loads on ships, or to figure out the gas dispersion over helicopter and passenger decks. Above all, it is the ideal place to test and improve new wind energy solutions. Eindhoven University of Technology has always been well known for its work in the field of aerodynamics and wind engineering. It combines close ties to industry and business with a tradition of scientific, technological, and practical expertise. One of a kind, this brand new wind tunnel fits perfectly within this heritage. It will stimulate our quest for new knowledge and enable us to perform research, pushing the boundaries of science and engineering.